Hello and welcome back to the construction of this almost ready to fly Douglas DC-3 radio control flying model. Please subscribe to support our channel. My wife and I chose this particular scheme rather than the dark green military scheme, as this scheme exudes the glamour of 1930s and 1940s air travel. However, it might not be too easy to see against grey British skies. So as I alluded to in the last episode, we're going to fit high brightness LEDs.
To the wingtip panels. Once again, nicely made with pull-through cords provided for the servo wires. So let's start then by marking out and cutting some holes. And we're going to have red and green wingtip navigation lights and leading edge landing lights with white LEDs. I'm going to cut the holes using a variety of techniques, using both the bandsaw, the fret saw and the razor saw. These little bits of light ply hold the LEDs in position. Using PLA plastic as a pull-through works great though. If I hadn't have cut the holes for the landing lights, I would never have seen this. But looking inside the wing, there is no spar exactly. Just a light ply webbing, which has been fretted away at each rib bay. Not great. Continuing with the rest of the assembly of the wingtip panels then, and the installation of the servos. This is all very easy and typical almost ready to fly. There is quite a bit more soldering going on as well, but it doesn't show very well, just the back of my head really when we're soldering, so I haven't bothered putting it on the film. Once again, here we're pinning the hinges using cocktail sticks, and this ensures that they will never pull out in flight. Now we are ready to connect up the control surfaces. First, center the aileron servos and drive the flap servos fully up. Add the servo arms in the orientations shown, and then the horns should be installed like this. So the flaps should face backwards and the ailerons should face forwards. The arms leaning forwards on the servos ensures some differential on the ailerons, i.e. more up travel than down, and this will improve handling and reduce the tendency for the aeroplane to tip stall in a tight turn. Don't forget to file little flats on the wire push rods and assemble all the hardware using threadlock. I'm not a big fan of the servos being mounted out in the breeze like this, but it just seems to be how ARTFs are done these days.
Now, it is important to ensure that these motors turn inwards like this, so that if one speed controller fails, for instance, or one motor seizes, that the resultant torque is helping you to fly the plane, not fighting you. So we'll just check that before we put these covers on, and one of these servo testers is a really handy gadget for doing this. There we go, like that. If either of them are backwards, then we can exchange any two of these three speed controller wires.
To do this, you do need a left hand and a right hand rotation propeller though. In this case, we have a pusher and a puller, which is exactly the same thing. We will mount them with the curved surfaces facing forwards in both cases.
We do of course have to balance them using this simple balancer and the sanding block. we're looking for it to come to rest at a random position. Looks like we need a little off the back of this one.
On a twin engine model, such as this, the torque reactions will be cancelled from both motors, and so the handling should be really nice. Now, I don't know of any modellers who actually like using vacuum form mouldings such as these nacelle covers. However, using a rotary tool such as a Dremel and taking your time, using elastic bands to hold the parts while the holes are drilled, it is possible to make a reasonable job. The mouldings didn't quite conform to the top of the wings perfectly, so I did use a few spots of glue here and there in the end. These wooden incidence dowels didn't fit very well, so I replaced them with some aluminium rod I had in stock from the hardware shop. And then we'll double check that both wingtips are at the same incidence.
That's all for this episode. Please subscribe to support our channel. And as I leave you now, I'm just going to drop the ambient light so you can get a good look at this LED lighting. See you next time.